Today on the show, we straddle both sides of the New South Wales-Victorian border as we take part in the annual Rodeo Christmas Run, which begins on the edge of the Snowy Mountains in Tumbarumba. From there, we'll follow the Murray River up to Finley and then take a look at one of Australia's most iconic rodeos in Myrtleford before bringing you all the action from Yarrawonga. Let's check in with our own Guy McPhee, who is somewhere between New South Wales and Victoria.
Behind me is the beautiful Lake Mulwala, separating the twin towns of Yarrawonga and Mulwala, where Victoria meets New South Wales. This is ski country 364 days a year, but not today. Today, this country town is gearing up for the annual Yarrawonga Rodeo. Competitors in each event travel from all around Australia to battle it out, and unlike most professional sports, these athletes pay to play, giving them the chance to make it into the winner's circle. But before we plunge in, let's take a look at what happened in Tumbarumba on New Year's Day, proudly brought to you by ARB.
At the foothills of the Snowy Mountains, the area around Tumbarumba is a pristine wilderness. The town is charmingly unspoiled and virtually untouched.
Welcome to the 2014 Tumbarumba Pro Rodeo.
Tumbarumba Rodeo has a long and rich history. The event is always held on New Year's Day, and this year will be its 69th consecutive rodeo, making it one of the longest running in the nation. We went along to find out just what makes it tick and why Aussie rodeo fans keep coming back.
Oh, the town gets right in behind the rodeo. It's always been a strong rodeo town. We've got a lot of handy cowboys, good cowboys come out of this town. A lot of good stock have come out of this town.
One of the great things about Tumbarumba is that they're committed to keeping old traditions alive. The committee is the only one in the APRA still providing their own horses, which compete alongside the contractor's stock.
Their committee horses here are bucked under strict supervision by either me or my boys. Many years ago, before the stock contractor came into play, it was all committee horses.
Town folk know they are good horses and they sort of treat them as their own a little bit. And this afternoon, with the likes of Slippery Gypsy and Brown Bomber and Tea for Tumba, those sorts of horses come out, I think you'll notice that the town get right behind them.
So with the stock locked and loaded for the event, one of the riders gaining a lot of support is a second-generation cowboy brimming with potential. Bryden Atkins match up against the reigning bucking bull War Chief was shaping up as the most anticipated event of the night, the classic battle between David and Goliath.
I expect if he can hear the 8-second hooter by the time his hand lets go, then we can see a 90-point bull ride today at Tumbarumba.
War Chief is an exceptional athlete. He's a bull with great agility and power, and he's very, very smart. He knows exactly how to throw a rider, and that's why after a vote of the top 15 bull riders, he earned his champion status in 2013. He's only been ridden once and never in the APRA.
I'm expecting a very good showing because Bryden Atkins, he has international experience. He's been over there and he's won over there. So he's right up there as far as bull riders go. But being a contractor, I always back the bull.
Can Atkins conquer this mighty beast? We'll show you how the ride played out a little later in the show. The timed events gave the crowd a taste of what was to come, starting with the steer wrestling. Scott Fitzpatrick won with a time of 3.7 seconds. Barrel racing is always one of the toughest events to win in any rodeo around Australia, and this win went to a first-timer in Tumbarumba, Nicole Fitzpatrick.
The barrel racing's really tight. The times can be like 1/100th of a second. You just got to go out and make the best run you can on the day with the ground, and that's pretty much all that you can do.
In the team roping, experience made the difference, with former Australian champion Gary McPhee picking up the check with his partner Andrew McWalter White.
Outside, Andrew moves into position, moves in, dallies that steer up and stretches it out.
It's a funny sport. When things aren't working well, it always seems to rush by. It seems like in slow motion when it all worked well. That just, you know, Gary turns them really nicely, just turn them away there, and we're a little bit stuck on the fence a couple both times, but we know we got them done.
It was another close race in the breakaway roping with less than a second between first and third. Stephanie Gard was quickest on the day with a time of 2.05 seconds.
She was a natural, didn't I?
Thomas Whitwell finished with the best time for the rope and tie event, 11.2 seconds. He's one of the youngest cowboys competing in the open ranks, making the victory all the more impressive.
Oh, I had a good calf, so I just made sure I kept him on his feet and then tried to just do a run. It was wasn't, I stuffed up a little bit on the ground, but just enough to get it won, so I was pretty happy about that.
With the timed events done and dusted, it was time to unleash the rough stock. First up, the bareback riders. It's the wild ride of rodeo. The harder and higher the horse bucks, the more points they can score. It's an adrenaline-pumping ride where anything can and usually does happen. Toby Collins is the only competitor at Tumbarumba competing in all three rough stock events. And tonight, the Victorian farrier snared the bareback event. But you never give up, you never give. He has awesome timing and control, doesn't he? And there he is on the horse named Swamp Mouse, performing brilliantly there to score 77 points. Moving on to the Saddle Bronx, which very rarely disappoint, and today was no exception. It was super tight at the top, though, because all five competitors who collected checks scored within 3 points of each other, and the two winners, Lee Bowker and Cody Anglin, couldn't be split. Let's take a look at Lee's ride on China Doll.
Oh, picture-perfect Saddle Bronx riding, jump and kick, he's not going to miss a lick either.
And here's Cody Anglin on Blue Horizon to equal Lee's score of 73 and tie the event. All this action was a fantastic build-up to the main event, the real draw card of Tumbarumba, the bull riding. After his win in the bareback event, Toby Collins was still feeling good when he jumped on a bull named Pancho. He really put on the pressure here with a very convincing ride, scoring 85 points. Here's a tidy piece of riding as Jack MacArthur manages to hold on to a Cobra Insane. The judges awarded him 75 points and he went into a well-deserved second spot. Next up was Brad Pierce, former APRA bull riding champion and past Rookie of the Year in the United States. Here he is on Dirty Water. Great ride and scored just shy of the 90-point mark, elevating him to first position. But Tumbarumba saved the best till last. The final ride of the rodeo belonged to the 2013 Australian Bucking Bull of the Year, War Chief. He's never been successfully ridden in the Australian professional circuit, and here, Bryden Atkins had his chance to rise to another class. But there you go. War Chief continues his dominance, proving too tough for Bryden. Never mind, the 20-year-old can now count himself on a long list of riders unable to stay aboard the legendary War Chief. So that left Brad Pierce with an 89-point win on Dirty Water over Toby Collins with his 85-point ride and Jack MacArthur in third on 75. As this year's event wraps up, the focus is now turning to 2015, when Tumbarumba will bring in the new year with a bang. And it's going to be a big one too, celebrating their platinum anniversary, 70 years of the Tumbarumba Rodeo. Well, we're back at our home base of Yarrawonga, where more than 250 riders and an expected crowd of over 3,000 people are gathering ready for the Yarrawonga Rodeo that we'll show you a little later in the program. Over the weekend, the town really gets behind the event and adds another dimension to the already desirable holiday destination. Before we head off to our next event in Myrtleford, let's check in with Guy McPhee, who's rounded up one of the busiest cowboys on the Christmas run, Toby Collins.
Well, as tonight's event is about to begin, I'm joined here by Toby Collins. Toby, one of the competitors from the Myrtleford Golden Spurs Rodeo. Welcome, Toby.
Thanks, Guy.
Now, Toby, tell me about the performance that you had at Myrtleford.
Yeah, I had a good performance at Myrtleford. I rode all my stock there and snuck in for a place in the bareback riding, so it was a good day for me.
Fantastic, great effort. Yeah. And now, here we are tonight at Yarrawonga Pro Rodeo. What can we expect from tonight's performance?
Yeah, I'm hoping to expect it to be good. I've got good draws and it should be a good night.
Fantastic. Well, folks, I tell you what, we certainly keep our eyes peeled on that one. But right now, let's cross over and have a look at some of the highlights from Myrtleford's 60th Annual Golden Spurs Pro Rodeo, proudly brought to you by Brigalow Clothing.
Celebrating their 60th anniversary this year, the Myrtleford Golden Spurs Rodeo is one of the highlights of the rodeo calendar every year. It's regarded as having one of the country's most spectacular rodeo arenas, offering some excellent vantage points for all the fans. Myrtleford Rodeo is held on Boxing Day every year, and die-hard cowboys and cowgirls all sacrifice time with their families on Christmas Day to travel here.
I think the thing about when you come to these rodeos that have been running for 60 years, this crowd know what to expect, and the pressure's on because they are looking for quality rides, they're looking for record runs. So from either end of the arena, it's going to be action aplenty.
Tiff Rayner is about as local as they come in Myrtleford. Starting out as a cinema enthusiast in the 1950s, the RSL, which ran the rodeo, asked him to make a short film, which he did using his 8mm camera.
The first short film I made was not here on this ground, but was at the old football ground, and that was in 1957. In those days, it was a much bigger arena, it was just hard ground. They didn't even start to plough up the ground until into the 60s, and riders really hit the dirt. When they hit the dirt, they hit it hard.
The vision really shows a wonderful comparison of what's changed and what's stayed the same, and just how far rodeo has come over the past 5 decades.
The greatest part about showing that film, especially for the older people, because there are faces that will be seen that are no longer around, it's unique. When it was first established, there wasn't much rodeo in Australia, and I've seen this happen. People would come from as far away as, well, all over the state, and it became a venue for Boxing Day for people.
They continue to make the journey here come rain, hail or shine, and this year was no different.
I'm working on love, I'm working on a plan, I'm willing at time, I'm working on a man, shoulder to the wheel, trying to get over that hill.
The rain may have been falling, but so were the calves in the team roping. The lethal combination of Clint Purse and Brody Moss made quick work of their run. The sky soon cleared, though, just in time for the body-bruising contest of steer wrestling. Paul Kenny wasn't bothered by the mud, showing everyone how it was done. The bareback event kicked off with Jason Gorsuch. He's a veteran in his 25th year riding, so as you can see from this ride, he's showing no signs of slowing down. And that ride earned him 74 points. Cody Anglin was off next on the horse named Outback Jack. He's definitely pleased with this performance, taking him to second place with 73 points. Matt Turner was runner-up here last year. This year he drew the Australian record-holding horse Rambling Angel. He just narrowly missed a hoof to the chest on the way down. The judges not only decided that Matt made the 8 seconds, but also rode well enough to score 79 points, skyrocketing him straight to number one.
Yeah, that particular horse I've been on 3 times before. Every year that I've been bareback riding, I've at least drawn that horse 1 time, and he's bucked me off every time. Until tonight was the first time I've finally been able to get him done.
This year's rodeo featured the ladies' buck jump for the first time. The crowd rallied behind both Rebecca and Christy. Unfortunately, neither made the 8, but there's no doubt it'll be an event that grows over time. In the early session of the men's saddle bronc competition, Cody Anglin was still at his blistering best when he jumped aboard Little Lil. His effort scored him 75 points, forming the benchmark for the final session of the evening. Lee Bowker threw everything he had at Barroa, but it was only enough to take an equal lead. Glenn Kent then had the opportunity to take it all aboard Country Rock. But as luck would have it, Glenn also received 75 points, and so 3 riders were forced to split the first place money. When it comes to the open bull riding, Myrtleford's event plays out a little differently compared to other venues. Everyone rides once, then the 5 highest point scorers continue through to a shootout final. They then compete a second time, and if they reach 8 seconds, the scores from both rides are combined to determine the overall winner. The afternoon session was exhilarating. Brad Franklin was thrown off dirty water, getting the bullfighters working early. Matt Darbany made a quick recovery, but as you'll soon see, it wasn't his last big hit for the night. Mitch Power made his trip all the way from the beef capital of Australia, Rockhampton, in central Queensland, and made sure the long journey was all worthwhile. Oh, that looked as though it could have gone bad quick, but everyone has walked away okay, thankfully. The ride scored Mitch 85 points, which should be enough to make it into the shootout final, but I don't know that I'd be that keen to get back on another bull after that. Darcy Murray and Luke Davidson also completed rides, but no one could guarantee positions in the final. Another 22 entrants had a chance to raise the bar later in the evening. Let's return now to the arena to see how they performed. With a large crowd settled in for a night of action, it was time for Rhys Anglin to turn on the magic, and he sure did impress with another strong showing, this time on Night Stalker. It was a fantastic ride, but Rhys had to limp out of the ring due to a knee injury. Night Stalker still wasn't finished though, ramming Matt Darmody into the fence here. Rhys received 89 points for the ride, putting him in front, but that injury left his final hopes very much in limbo.
A couple jumps there, I was doing a bit of hanging on, I nearly bucked off, but that was just because he was a smart bull and moved away from me, and I was just lucky to catch him up, and yeah, we kind of got in a groove together, and yeah, we got a good score, 89 points.
Back to the arena, and Corey Waterson lit up the ring when the gate cracked on White Lightning. But the bullfighters did an even better job stopping the animal from causing any extra carnage. At the end of the first round, these were the standings for the open bull ride. Rhys Anglin in top spot, then Troy Wilkinson on 86 points, followed by Mitchell Power, Corey Waterson and Darcy Murray. Unfortunately though, Rhys couldn't overcome his injury from the first round, which stopped him from riding in the final, but that paved the way for Luke Davidson to compete in the shootout final in his place. We'll return to the shootout action shortly, but first let's go to the timed event end of the arena, where competitors were getting organised for the breakaway and the steer roping events. Stephanie Gard took out the breakaway category with an outstanding time of 2.95 seconds. And here's Glenn Perkins' run during the steer roping. He won in 4 seconds flat. Back now to the main event, where five riders and five bulls were about to go head to head. Each man was angling to make the 8 seconds and earn themselves a $4,000 bonus. The bulls' lineup started strongly with Black Dog. He made quick work of Luke Davidson. After scoring 81 points with his first ride, Darcy Murray had his second go. Darcy got hung up here, and to make things worse, check this out. Two bullfighters get thrown as well. Now have a look at what happened next as one of the cowboys from out the back runs in, launches himself at the bull to free Darcy's hand. It's unbelievable stuff. After all that action, Troy Wilkinson still had a job to do but barely got out of the chutes. So, with three riders down without any points on the board, Corey Waterson had his second turn, this time on a Cobra Suicidal. But it was a case of another rider biting the dust. That left Mitchell Power as the only finals hopeful, but he had a very tough task ahead of him. Mitchell drew the current Bucking Bull of the Year, War Chief. Unfortunately, he was no match for the champion bull though, meaning Myrtleford get to keep the $4,000 shootout cash. After no successful rides in the final, the winner was determined from the points in the first round. So it seems Rhys Anglin's injury wasn't in vain at all. His 89 points was deemed the Golden Spurs winner for this year's Myrtleford Rodeo. So that wraps up another thrilling summer rodeo for the Myrtleford Lions Club. The fans that make it all possible will be back again next year when organisers build on the next chapter of their 60-year success story. When we return, we'll have plenty more action from this year's Rodeo Christmas run. Yarrawonga and Mulwala are separated by the beautiful Murray River and boast the stunning man-made Lake Mulwala. The area is renowned for having plenty of sunshine and wide open landscapes, and the lake is an unforgettable sight with its somewhat majestic and ghostly river gums. Water skiing, sailing, fishing and cruising are all popular activities out on the lake, and tourists and travellers trek from all over the country to check out this incredible little spot. The town's other draw card is the very impressive Yarrawonga Mulwala Golf Club Resort, nestled along the banks of the Murray River. It's the country's largest public access golf course, and today it looks as though some of the cowboys are making use of the facilities before this afternoon's rodeo action gets underway. The next event on our trip is in the peaceful rural town of Finley, and it's proudly brought to you by Lucas Oils. Finley is a peaceful riverina town that's surrounded by farmland, only 10 minutes drive from the Victorian border and the waters of the mighty Murray River. The Finley Rodeo is now in its 30th year, and Rod Harris and his brother Rick took over the event in the 90s, and it's now a major event for the rural town.
Well, we got some top riders here, you know, like top bulls and top riders and top horses, and we're expecting probably 2,000 to 3,000 people at our rodeo tonight.
Guy McPhee was involved in the first rodeo in 1984 and has provided stock for the event ever since.
It's been a great rodeo for a lot of years, so it has a great following.
The ladies kicked off this year's competition in Finley with the barrel racing. This has to be the toughest event to win in rodeo at the moment. There are so many quality cowgirl competitors, and people come from all over the country to take part in events just like this. Today was a perfect example of how close the competition is. Of the 6 racers who placed in today's event, all were within 3/10 of a second of each other. Here's Tennille Little, who took out the event with a 16.56 second ride. Once the barrels were cleared away, Terry Everson showed the crowd why he's a 15-time national finalist, outclassing the field with his 10-second run to take out the rope and tie.
Everybody got hands to beat that thing. Beautiful!
It was a case of history repeating itself in the steer wrestling. Paul Kenny made it 2 years in a row with a 3.75-second masterclass. The ladies in the breakaway competition had a very tough task ahead of them, as earlier in the morning, Nicole Fitzpatrick made history in her first Finley Rodeo, breaking the Australian record by roping her calf in 1.85 seconds.
So it is a fair bit to do with timing to get your tight, like the fastest time. So there wasn't that much on the barrier today, so you could kind of make sure your calf was going and go with it.
One of Finley's feature events is scarcely seen at rodeos nowadays, the Poley Buck Jump. It's an event that reflects the bronc riding of yesteryear, when station hands would come in from the surrounding areas and use their stock saddles to compete. Riders have 2 tasks, cracking a stock whip and riding a bucking horse. Points are awarded in both categories and are then combined to give the overall score. Tyler Pendergast was the standout at this year's event. He only received 23 points for the ride, but his ability with the whip gave him an extra 60 points, making a combined total of 83.
Yeah, look, it was a little bit wild western before I actually got on it, played up a little bit in the shoot, but, and then, I got on it, and it come out, and the first few ones are pretty juicy, and then I sort of got into a bit of a rhythm where I, you know, cracked the whip, sort of done a bit of flair, a few tricks and stuff to try and gain a few extra points, and, yeah, it sort of flattened out a little bit towards the end where I could show off a little bit more, which worked out pretty good.
Onto the saddle bronc ride, and the 2 Anglin brothers were hoping it would be a family affair, with both coming off wins in Deniliquin and Tumbarumba. Reese is constantly high on the winners list but was riding injured, and Cody was going to have to overcome the 4 times bucking horse of the year, Cheyenne Top Girl.
Cowboys busting out of the chute.
For Cody, success was only just out of his reach, falling slightly short of the 8-second mark on what would have otherwise been a high-scoring ride. Little brother Reese was up next. With a top piece of riding on the McPhee mare, Cajun Lady, Reese received 85 points to take out the event. Over the past 5 years, the bareback event has been a one-man show in Finley. Fred Osman has taken out the event 4 times in 4 years, so today he had the chance to make it 5 in a row. On a horse named Ridiculous, Fred's form in Finley was just that. With an 81-point ride, Fred Osman continues his dominance as the Finley bareback champ.
Been coming to Gary's rodeos for a lot of years and seen all his young horses, and like I said, I'd seen that horse before and I knew it was kind of western and lively, you know, just like all these young horses are. So I just thought I'd ride it the same as all of them, you know.
The crowd got amongst all the rodeo action in Finley this year, but the bull ride is when the audience really ends up on the edge of their seats. Let's go back and check out what happened in the first round of the open bull riding. Rookie of the Year front runner Sean Lynch was the first to make his mark. On the bull named Blow Me Apart, he scored 79 points. After his win in Tumbarumba, Brad Pierce was always going to be one to watch. Unfortunately, the bull's step toe was able to throw Brad just before the 8 seconds was up. When they cracked the gate on Drover's run, Luke Fielder rode him to a standstill. Rincey Jamison keeping Luke on his toes at the end there. So after the first half of the rides were complete, only two scores were on the board. Sean Lynch was out in front with 79, and Luke Fielder's ride earned him 75 points. In the final round at Finley, Troy Wilkinson got the crowd amped on the bull called Outback. Looked like a great ride, but he lost his concentration and balance right at the end. A score of 83 points takes Troy to the lead, just not sure how much that lapse at the end cost him. One of the last rides for Finley went to Western Australian cowboy Jared Oversby on the bull Blood and Bone. That ride put him in front of Troy Wilkinson with 85 points, a fantastic effort to come in right at the end and take home the money.
Yeah, no, it was real good. I didn't know the bull or nothing, but he just came out and did his job, and I was lucky enough to be there for the eight. You can't ask for a nicer spinning bull. That's what you want every bull to do, just out there and around the left into the end.
The Finley Rodeo was one to remember with plenty of thrills and spills. The town will surely continue to get behind this great event in the future. After the break, it's what we've all been waiting for. This year's Yarrawonga Rodeo, proudly brought to you by Lucas Oils. Welcome back to Oz Rodeo, where we're about to show you all the highlights from Yarrawonga. The committee's been preparing and organising this event over the past 6 months, rightly tipping that there would be a great crowd who flocked into Yarrawonga showgrounds this afternoon.
Oh, it brings a lot of revenue into the town. There's a lot of cowboys and cowgirls that have to eat and drink and everything like that, and I'm hoping that there's 2,000 or 3,000 people here tonight and it creates an event for Yarrawonga.
We've sent Guy McPhee along to bring us all the action as it happens throughout the day.
Well, welcome to Yarrawonga Rodeo, and this is the main event. The crowd have arrived and the cowboys and cowgirls have been preparing for great pro rodeo action all day long. Now, things are about to get started with the grand entry. I'm going to head over to the arena. Let's get this thing on the road.
The grand entry sets this celebratory tone for the event and introduces the crowd to all the stars that make this such a great event.
You better hang on, because tonight you're in for the ride of your life. Yarrawonga, let's let the battle begin as we bring the action into centre ring.
Once the formalities were over, though, the team ropers kicked things off. Gary McPhee and Andrew McWalter White just came off a win at Tumbarumba. Gary, as calm as ever, got his job as the header sorted, and Andrew backed him up with a quick lasso around the heels in just 7.7 seconds. It was the quickest of the day. Following the team roping was the steer roping. William Blackwood has a good track record in Yarrawonga. He won the steer wrestling in this event a year ago. And he did it again with a very smooth 4.5 second run. It didn't take long for the sun to set and the barrel racers came out sprinting. Tennille Little is a three-time tour champion but has had an up and down Christmas run. She's certainly one to watch in Yarrawonga. Her 15.641 second run allowed her to take out the event and take home over $2,000 in prize money. Guy caught up with her just moments after her win.
Tell us, how did that feel?
It felt awesome. I love Yarrawonga Rodeo. It's a really great crowd and a real adrenaline rush. So, yeah, I'm feeling really great. This is one of my favourite rodeos to come to. I mean, they get a really big crowd and it's well promoted and the atmosphere is great. The music is, yeah, it's really good.
Having events one after another here on the Christmas run allows the riders to get into a groove and really fine-tune their skills. The guys in the bareback are a perfect example, and it's a noted group of riders who continually rank highly on the results ladder. Matt Turner has had a great Christmas run, winning in Myrtleford only days ago, and tonight he's on the horse named Scotty K. Matt won this event here last year, and with ability like that, it is no surprise. 77 points for his efforts tonight. That'll take him right into first position. Next rider to jump aboard was Western Australian cowboy Jared Oversby on Dark Shadow. J Jared held on for the eight with an exceptional piece of riding, but it was only enough to draw first position with Matt Turner, so the boys were left to split the winner's check.
As soon as I seen the draws, I couldn't wait to get on him. I seen a lot of guys bet a lot of points on that little horse, and he's as fun as they all say. So yeah. I'm just glad it worked out in the end.
Once the bareback boys finished, the breakaway ropers got underway. Sherry O'Donoghue dominated this event between 1999 and 2005. She roped away into top spot and to take the win with that 2.3 second run. Johnny Gordon was the last competitor in the steer wrestling and had to beat 4.5 seconds to take the win. He absolutely gripped it and ripped it with a time of 4.2 seconds, taking home the win and the money. Next, we're going to recap one of the rides from the Saddle Bronc event earlier today. Here's Brad Pearce. It was a very nice piece of riding, but we thought we would show you this as an example because, sadly, Brad missed his mark out. The rules state that the rider is to have both spurs in front of and touching the break of the bronc shoulders on its first move out of the chute. The rider's feet must still be in this position when the bronc's front feet hit the ground for the first time. So, unfortunately, that means no score for Brad today. We'll catch up with him a little later on to find out what happened. Back to tonight's Saddle Bronc event. First up was Sam Knight. He made a massive impact when he got up on one of McPhee's most decorated horses, Cheyenne Top Girl. This is gonna be a good night. Everything is all right. I think we can make it better. Sam received 79 points to go out in front, but Cody Anglin was yet to have his ride, and his form has been exceptional. Here he is now on The Man Named QT. Everything is all right. That's a huge upset, scoring 80 points. Let's hear from Guy behind the chutes who caught up with Cody straight after the ride.
Cody, a brilliant ride tonight. Take us through the steps of riding QT.
Well, you know, 540 Gary McPhee's QT. Mare that's been around for a long, long time. I've been lucky enough to get on her a couple times before she went to the breeding pen. And this is her first trip today in 2 years, and it just went outstanding. It was great. She jumped out there, jumped and kicked, and I was willing enough to be in time with her and spurring her, and you know, it couldn't work any better.
Now Yarrawonga's final show, the main event. Earlier on in the Slack 22, rides took place with only three scores, so Gary McPhee's bucking stock certainly had the advantage. Let's cross back down to Guy, who is with one of the riders.
Well, I'm joined here tonight by Brad Pearce. Now, we saw Brad earlier on tonight in the Saddle Bronc ride. How did things go?
I didn't have a real good run in the bronc ride, and I actually rode my horse, but I missed my mark out, which was have your spurs over the point of the shoulders in the first jump.
So right.
That was a bit of a my mistake deal, but apart from that, like the horse done everything it was meant to do, I just missed a little bit on my behalf.
Okay, so now tell us what's in store for the rest of the night.
I've got a bull to go in the last round called Scatter Tricks. I've never been on it before, but I've seen it, and it should just kick out a couple and turn back, and looks like a pretty good one to get on.
Fantastic. Well, we're looking forward to that. Now, the atmosphere here tonight's pretty wild. How do you think that's going to spur things on?
Oh, it's always. If no one was watching, you wouldn't get on, would you?
That's brilliant.
No, it's good to have a crowd like this at a show. It sort of gets the engine running and gets you keen to get on.
Fantastic. Well, there we have it. The words from Brad Pearce. We'll look forward to seeing him in the main arena a little later on.
Let's take a second to recap some of the action from the first round of the open bull ride. After the slack and first round of bull rides, Jack MacArthur was in front with 79 points, followed by Darcy Murray on 77, and in third, Cody Tyrrell. The last event for the evening is about to begin. Guy is right in amongst the action.
Well, here we are in the final round of the open bull ride at main stage as the cowboy now lowers himself down onto the back of the bull. Down here in the chutes, keep a keen eye on the cowboy as he places his hand in that loosely plaited nylon bull rope. Staying aboard this 800 kilo beast down here in the chutes is certainly no mean feat. Should he fail to remain on the bull for that 8 seconds or touch the bull with his free hand during the ride, he will be disqualified.
Whoa, that was a close one. Unfortunately, Toby Collins didn't reach the 8 seconds, so no points go to him for that ride. Brad Pearce, who we spoke with earlier, now gets his chance on the bull's scatter tricks. Oh, that was was very close. Brad's a rider who has competed so well during this run, just lost control at the end and what would have been a really nice scoring ride. He doesn't look very happy, does he? So Jack MacArthur is still in front at this stage with 79 points, but the next rider has the lineage to pull out something special. Roy Dunn, nephew of former world champion Troy Dunn, has drawn the bull out back. He's done it. He's held on. Roy just looked like he had that bull's measure and pulled off a ripper ride. With a score of 81 points, that makes Roy Dunn the winner of this year's Yarrawonga Rodeo Open Bull Ride for 2014. Roy's down with Guy McPhee.
Well, Roy, welcome along. You've had a great ride here tonight. Tell us a little bit about what it was like to ride that bull during this evening's performance.
Well, he's a good little bull. I remember talking to my uncle about him just earlier on this afternoon. Naturally, when you're sitting on the back of one and not much is going through your mind, but sometimes you can hear it, and when you hear the crowd amped up, it gets you jacked up too. And yeah, I just went at him like I would any other one, and just hope he's going to perform for me as well.
Thanks very much for joining us on Oz Rodeo. We have thoroughly enjoyed bringing you all the pro rodeo action as well as some of the sights and sounds of these wonderful country towns. We'll leave you as we do every week with the Mahindra Utes, Big Rides and Wrecks.